Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are going to talk the anatomy behind some of the clinical procedures that often involve meninges. So we know what they are now. Let's talk about some of the clinical procedures. And as you likely know, we are talking anatomy. So I won't get into how to do these procedures or what particular clinical findings you may find through these procedures, as that's not in my wheelhouse, but it is important to begin to understand the anatomy in the context of these clinical procedures. So let's start with spinal anesthesia. Sometimes you hear this referred to as a spinal block, and this is a general term for anesthetics entering the subarachnoid space. And recall, the subarachnoid space is that space between the arachnoid and the pia mater. This will anesthetize the region in which the anesthetic is entered and inferiorly, as anesthetic agents tend to be heavier than cerebrospinal fluid. So while the patient is inclined, it will keep the anesthetics in the inferior subarachnoid space. So say the anesthesia is entered here. It will anesthetize the nervous tissue here at this red line and inferior. Spinal anesthesia can be and often is a lumbar puncture. But I want to note immediately that a lumbar puncture does not have to be just the insertion of anesthetic. Now, that can be used to utilize for pain relief during specific procedures or during childbirth. But a lumbar puncture can also be a diagnostic tool with the withdrawal of cerebrospinal fluid or CSF to evaluate a variety of central nervous system disorders or surrounding structures, such as the potential of meningitis. The lumbar puncture needle enters the subarachnoid space through the midline, typically between the spinous processes of L3 and L4, or between L4 and L5. So it could be either one of those regions. And this is done at what's referred to as the supracrystal plane. And this plane is approximately at L4. So you can kind of see where the X is. That's indicating about where the anesthetic needs to be entered. You can kind of see that being done here. This line, the supracrystal line or plane, is at the superiormost portions of the iliac crests. All right, so here's one over here. You have one on the other side. So if you're putting your hands on your hips, you are palpating the iliac crests. And this is often easier than, say, counting the vertebrae. And this is an excellent place to do this because you do not have to worry about damaging the spinal cord, which ends at L2, but you're still within the dural sac, which of course will have the rest of the meninges and all that very important subarachnoid space. Now let's work through an epidural or an epidural block. This is anesthetics being entered into the epidural space. So not the subarachnoid space, but the epidural space. And recall that the spinal epidural space is an actual space. This can also occur at around the L4 level as well, but of course, you would not want to enter a needle or a catheter as deep as what you had with a lumbar puncture, as this is in the more superficial epidural space. So that needle would stop the level of the dura, not having to pass through the dura. Also, anesthetics can be entered into the epidural space around the sacral canal. This is referred to as a caudal epidural block. And this would specifically bathe the S2 through S4 spinal nerve roots with anesthetics, which would include pain fibers from the uterine cervix and superior vagina, so may be utilized for some pain relief during childbirth. So these are the anatomical bases of some of the clinical procedures that involve the meninges or their associated spaces. And here are the major points here in this summary slide. Thank you so much for your time and attention with these concepts, and have a great rest of your day.